Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you. Good morning, smiling faces out there. Welcome to Grace Fellowship Church. It is our pleasure to have you here to worship the Lord together. It is such an awesome opportunity just to communicate with Him and just get on His page, what He needs for us to do today. So I'm going to invite you to stand, and we have a few songs for you this morning. If you know them, sing them out, and just worship the Lord corporately together. All right? First one goes like this.
Still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Father God, each one of us here is a beautiful thing created out of the dust, from dust to dust. We praise you, Father, for that wonderful creation. We praise you, Father, for that wonderful love that you bestow on each one of us. And you look our way. You know us by name. We trust you and we love you. We are beautiful things because of who you are. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Good morning. Children are now dismissed, and you guys can take a couple minutes to walk around and greet each other. Welcome to Grace. If you are new or visiting today, we would love to connect with you. In your pocket, seat pockets in front of you, we have connect cards, just basic information, your name, your address, and we want to have you fill that out. You can take it to the welcome counter when you leave today. It's on the right-hand side. If you turn that in, we just have a simple gift for you, something to remember us by, and we just want to send a note in the mail home with you. And just answer any questions you might have about who we are and what we do and what makes us a family here at Grace. So feel free to fill that out, even if you've been coming for a couple weeks or 6 months. Go ahead and fill that out. Okay, so part of that information and being a family is getting a hold of each other. So if you can see, for the couple of years, we used the old directory on that side. That's the icon in your app on your phone or on your tablet. That directory is being phased out. We've been kind of talking about this since January. I'm super out of breath. I had way too much coffee. Okay, so let's slow it all down a little. Since January, we have transitioned from this program, the old directory, to the new program we're using called Church Center. So we've been promoting that for a little while now. It's an app. If you've downloaded the Church Directory app on your phone, could you just raise your hand? Because there's quite a lot of you. So if you are in the habit of calling people from the church, if you have, like if I had a question about something I wanted Andre's phone number, I would look it up in my Church Center app, and that's where I would find it. In order for that to happen, you have to download the app, you have to log into the app, then you have to choose to share your information in the directory. What the old app had, the old directory, everybody's information was there if you belonged to it. This new program we're using, you have to choose to share that information. Kim, can you go to the next slide? Thank you. So you're going to download the app. You're going to find Grace of Amador in it. It's very simple. You're going to verify either your email or your phone number. Then you're going to choose to share your information. See on the bottom there, if you hit directory and you get that banner on the bottom and it says share now, that means no one can see your information yet. So pretty soon that old directory is going to be gone and the people aren't going to be able to give you a call or send you a card in the mail. And people at home, that works for you too if you're watching this during the week or from YouTube. Our friends who've moved away, you also can download this app, add your information, and choose to share it. So often we want to talk to each other. If any of that's confusing, I can help you with all of it. There's a pamphlet in the lobby on the little black table in there walking you through step by step. But eventually the old directory is going to go away, so if you want your information shared, you've got to download the new one. Okay. Within that new app, the Church Center app, is all sorts of things that you can sign up for, including being part of the WOW group. So on Wednesdays, every Wednesday here in the morning, we have a group of people show up, men and women, to help keep the facility up. Especially this time of year, we have people in and out all the time with our creative arts camp coming up. Little things that need to be taken care of. That's what you could do on a Wednesday. If you are not available on a Wednesday morning, you can always call the church and say, what's something on the list that needs to get done? Random things like vacuuming up above, what's the word for that in the old school term? Vestibule, back up there. That needs to be vacuumed on occasion, stuff like that, little things. So that's WOW, work on Wednesdays for men and women. You can be helping in that. So CAC, our Creative Arts Camp, our VBS, is coming up in just a few weeks. After church today is a meeting for all volunteers for Creative Arts Camp. It's lunch is provided. So if you didn't know about this prior and you're just hearing about it, stay. All of the information is very important that Dana's going to give you in packets right after church. Lunch is provided, so go ahead and stay for that. And one thing that we really need right now is water bottle donations and people to also support and sponsor snacks. So you don't have to go to the grocery store or to Costco to buy the snacks. You're just going to donate or sponsor money toward that, and the snack volunteers are going to do all those purchases. But water bottles are key. Last year when we did it, kids drink a lot of water, and there's going to be 300-plus people in this building every single day who are thirsty. So if you could bring water bottle donations, we would really appreciate that. So a couple quick reminders. If you open up your bulletin today, there's a lot of things happening because it's spring, especially in the next couple of weeks. So just some things to remember, and all the information is in here or online. Women's Spring Bling, you can sign up for that. The Men's Trap Shoot, you can sign up for that, or look for the guys with the red clipboards. Boy Scouts are having a luncheon on Mother's Day. You saw them when you got in, when you got here today. They have their sign-up table in the lobby that you can sign up for that. And then lastly, reminding you, we're having a baptism Sunday on May 21st. If you want to be baptized, come talk to me. Let me know, or Pastor Mark, or let the office know. We're going to have a class on, I believe it's next Sunday. Let's look. I did not just do this, I promise. The baptism class is happening. I think it's next Sunday at 9 a.m. Sorry. So if you want to get baptized, you can sign up for that. And we're going to do it in church on the 21st, right after service. I'm very scattered this morning, y'all. Thanks for bearing with me. Some days I have it all together, and some days I'm just all over the place. So here at Grace, all of these things happen because of offering and how our people give so generously and so humbly. If you do want to give, there's a box in the back. You can give digitally, or you can send your donation in the mail. Would you pray with me? Lord, if there's anyone else who feels like me this morning, so scattered, mind thinking about so many different things, maybe just a little bit too much caffeine, would you just settle our hearts, Lord? Holy Spirit, would you fill this room? We're here to honor you and worship you this morning. Would you just fill us and remind us that you are why we are here. We are created in your image, and we worship you this morning in so many different ways, with our time, with our talents, Lord, and with our tithe. Would you bless everyone in this building and our worship team and Pastor Mark for the rest of the service? In your name, amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood.
we could all stand for the reading of the word this morning.
Good morning, Grace. We're reading out of 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 10 this morning. Therefore, rid yourself of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Let newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk so by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in the scriptures it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one that who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious. But to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone, the stone that causes men to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. But you are chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare praises of him who called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are a people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Blessed is this word. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome. If you are visiting today, I want to welcome you. My name is Mark. I am a pastor here at Grace, having the privilege of bringing the word this morning. And if you were here last week, you heard me mention that yesterday I was running in a trail race of a distance that would make me not feel as good by the end, a 21-mile trail race down in Folsom. And I'm here. I'm not limping around or anything. I completed the race. Let me give you here's my strategy for running that kind of distance. Number one, run slowly. Don't burn too many matches in the beginning. Run slowly and eat all the snacks. You know, who wouldn't want to do that? You're just enjoying the trail, you're running slowly, having conversation with people, enjoying a beautiful day. So I was really appreciative of the opportunity, just thanking the Lord for being in his beauty, having the ability to do something physical like that, which is really what I enjoy. But I have to confess, the last 3 miles were quite painful. But I pushed through and completed the race. Kind of a metaphor for life sometimes. So as we are in 1 Peter this morning, we are already begun by reading the beginning of chapter 2. But if you are thinking about the argument of Peter as he is proclaiming a particular message, the verses that we're starting with, chapter 2, verse 1, is actually in the middle of a greater argument. And so we have to kind of go backward and do some review and so on. And the purpose of Peter is to help God's people understand that they belong and they are a people of value. This is a core desire for every single human being. Every single one of us can identify this, can't we? I mean, we grow up wanting to belong. We have an identity, and we want to be a part of something that declares, "I am valuable. And when we ask somebody, you know, just how you introduce yourself, tell me about yourself, we often use terms of identity and value to help someone to understand who we are. We have kids at home, or this is my occupation. We start with something, or tell me a little more. We talk about a hobby, something that gives a sense of who you are, where you belong, where do you fit in to the world. And you know, if I'm young in the world, I'm going to be in some entry-level job position. Maybe that's not my long-term goal, because that's not going to pay the bills as well as somewhere down the road. But maybe I'm in college, it's a part of my identity. If I'm beginning to work in the trades, it's a means to an end. I'm getting to a point where I'm going to learn something that nobody else knows, or very few people know. Therefore, it has value. Someone's going to pay me because I pay people to work on my pickup. You don't want me working on my pickup. I got an old 80s Toyota pickup for the reason that, in my head, you know what? This is something I can work on. I can wrench on this truck. I have changed the oil. That's the only thing I've ever done on my pickup. I do not do work on vehicles, and because I've tried. And it usually ends with a small project turning into a very large project that costs a lot more. Lots of, trips back and forth, either looking at YouTube videos. How am I supposed to even do this? And I'm like, you know what? I value people who are trained and experienced in the realm of auto mechanics. We value people who build things. We value people who can do our taxes. We value people who have a special set of skills, right? It's a part of our value, a part of identity. All of us, though socially, want to belong to something because you value me for me. Not just a trade or a craft or a skill that I can bring to the table, but deep down, I want you to value me for me. This is the heart of the message of 1 Peter. First of all, you are a valued member of a community. Even though the world around you, Peter would say to his audience, do not value you, you are precious and you are chosen by God. So, that's the first part of the message is, who are you? What is your identity and value in this community of faith in the world in which we live? And secondly, because the rest of the world doesn't really see things the way we do, and it doesn't value us the way we do, how do we live in a society that holds a different set of values? Doesn't value me the way that maybe God values me. Message of 1 Peter. So let's kind of bring us back up to where we are in Scripture. The message titled for today is Jesus' Cornerstone, or Jesus' Identity. I was kind of going back and forth between those two. One emphasizes Jesus as the foundation. The other one is who Peter's declaring who we are in Jesus. You could choose your title. They both work for this. Because he's reminding the recipients of this letter, he calls them exiles. Another place later in chapter 2, he calls them sojourners. And the definition of an exile, why he chooses this term, is that the definition is it's a person who for a period of time lives in a place which is not their normal residence, an alien, a stranger, temporary resident. And there's two reasons he identifies them as this. One is that they are marginalized in their social status. They are people who aren't valued that much in their culture, in their society. They're marginalized socially. Many of them are slaves, or generally people who are foreigners or aliens to that area. They do not have the rights, maybe intrinsic to someone else that's of a higher rung on the hierarchical ladder of society in that day. So they're feeling this sense of marginalization. And we can all identify with this. You know, I'm not like so-and-so. I wish I were more like this. Or we feel like we're not in the in crowd for whatever reason, the color of our skin, our gender, whatever it is, that is keeping us apart from the things that other people may experience the good receptivity of our culture. And as Christians, oftentimes we feel marginalized. And so that's the second definition why he uses the word exile, is because of their faith in Jesus, not only are they already socially marginalized, but because of their faith, it just gets harder for them. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more in the weeks to come. And so part of Peter's message, because that's true of you, let's talk about your new status. This is what God thinks of you. And we all want to belong. We all want to be able to have an identity. So God declares this identity for them. First of all, that they are born again into a living hope. The family you were born into kind of put you in a certain place, a certain social sphere in that first century. That they're experiencing marginalization. But when you place your faith in Jesus, you are born again into a new identity, a new status that God has placed a tremendous amount of value, and you're part of a faith community that loves one another intensely. You're born again to a living hope. Second of all, you have a valuable and permanent inheritance. So in the first century, if I don't own land, if I'm not a person in the household who's even eligible to own land, I'm always going to have a lower social status. But those who believe in Jesus, Peter reminds them, that you have a permanent inheritance waiting in heaven for you. God has chosen you. You are precious to him, and you have an inheritance that's worth far more than the riches on this earth, like silver or gold or land. Is something that is eternal. Whereas silver, gold, the material wealth is here today, but we can't take it with us. It's here today, but it's subject to corruption, thieves breaking in and stealing. We have an investment that didn't pan out. We've lost our retirement or whatever that is. Some of us have experienced that, the transient nature of wealth, where it says for a believer, your inheritance is permanent. It's unfading. It's untarnished. It will outlast everything else. This is the new status of believers. And thirdly, you are guarded by God himself, though you are going to go through some rough times. People aren't going to value you in your surrounding culture. And that's okay, because God will honor you when he sees you face to face. He will say, well done, good and faithful servant. So, to define the values and identity of this new people that gain all the benefit of this new status, Peter would go on to say in chapter 1, we've already studied this, to outline the ethics of that new community. What's it like? What's our ethos to be a part of this community? What are our slogans? What kind of lives do we live that makes somebody else want to be a part of this community? I mean, we already have this great elevated status in this community, but how do we treat one another? What are our lives to reflect in this community? And so he establishes the ethics of the community. We've studied this last week in chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. He says, be holy as God is holy. That is the standard of how we ought to live. The very character of God, who comes to dwell in us now, we in turn live out his very character, his goodness, his love, his mercy, his justice. We reflect that. Be holy as God is holy. We reflect all the very character traits of God. And then in chapter 1, verse 22, and this is just before the passage we had read this morning, he's moving into how do we treat one another, that we love one another earnestly with brotherly love. So if you have your Bible, look there in chapter 22. He says, having purified your souls by obedience to the truth, this is being holy as God is holy, for in sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. We love God first and foremost, and we love one another. These are the two hallmarks of the Christian faith that Peter is identifying. This should be the ethos of this faith community. You have been given all of this elevated status as a community. This is how we live now, to reflect the very character of God, loving him foremost and loving one another. So in chapter 2, verse 1, that's why it begins with the word so, or therefore, or as a result. This is what you ought to do. Positively, he says, love one another. Negatively, avoid these things. Chapter 2, verse 1, we are to put away those characteristics of our former life. Chapter 2, verse 1. So put away all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, and envy, and all slander. These are elements that break down the community, that disrupt the community, that are contrary to the brotherly love that we are supposed to share with one another. Like a core value of the Christian faith that Paul would write is that we put someone else, their interests, ahead of our own. That's a characteristic of brotherly love, or the love that we have for one another. I'm going to care for you. I'm going to think about you first, not me first. It doesn't mean I'm not going to care about the things I enjoy or things that are good for me. But when I enter a room or I see other people are involved and we're doing something common, I'm not just going to do what I want to do. I'm not just going to do what I think is good for me, but I'm going to consider everybody else in the room to make sure that my actions and their actions, that we can come together in a way that's good for everybody. And sometimes that means I have to give up a little bit of something that I desire for the sake that everyone gets to enjoy something good. That's a common virtue of being a part of the faith community, to put someone else's interests ahead of my own. This is what it means to be a Christian. That sounds pretty good. If I know that I'm going to be cared for, I know I'm going to be loved, that you're not going to just act in a selfish way, but you're going to consider my needs and my desires, and we're going to come collectively to decisions together. That would be these are all virtues of the community of faith. So we should actively put away all malice and deceit. And then, he says, we are to grow up. This is a common idea of all cultures, that you start out as a baby in this world, but if you're going to be healthy, if you're going to be mature, you grow up as an adult, you put away childish things, and you embrace the responsibilities and care and maturity and patience and character that is aligned with a mature, healthy adult. This is how Peter says it in chapter 2. You put all that bad stuff off. Verse 2, instead, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Let's unpack that a little bit. This is how Peter concludes the ethics of the community. This is our values. This is what defines us a bit in how we act toward one another. This important trait is to grow up into maturity, to grow up into our salvation, what characterizes the community faith. We don't start out that way. We have to learn it. We don't start out that way. We have to choose day to day to grow in toward that. How do we do that? By craving the pure spiritual milk, like a newborn baby. Now, this metaphor of a baby is something that's sometimes used positively and sometimes used negatively. It's like other writers of Scripture say, well, don't be like infants in your thinking. I mean, you've been believers for a long time. By this time, you should be teachers. That's the book of Hebrews, right? It's a bad thing to be an infant. But what quality or characteristic of an infant is good here that Peter is saying, this is really important that you're like an infant? It's how you crave, what you crave. If pure spiritual milk is what's going to get you to grow up into your salvation, crave it like a newborn baby. There are a few things that a newborn baby knows how to do. And really only one that they do by choice, and that's eat. Sleep and fill their diaper. The other things that just happen, those are bodily functions. It's not like a moral choice or anything. It's what they do. They eat, then they, get milk drunk and they fall asleep. But if they're hungry, they know exactly how to communicate their hunger, their craving, their desire, which is very intense for them. And in fact, if I can't eat right now, this moment, I'm going to do what? I'm going to cry, right? I'm going to communicate. My only method of communication, I learn it from day one. I want to eat. I come out of the womb hungry. I'm either eating or sleeping or filling my diaper. There's nothing more important to me than eating. I'm going to communicate. That truth, and this is the truth that Peter says, just like that newborn infant, crave spiritual milk, because that is how you're going to grow. You focus on it. You put your attention to it. You put make it a very high priority in your life. So what is the spiritual milk? This is another metaphor that Peter uses. We don't know exactly what he's saying, but if we're looking at Greek words, it could point to the Word of God, or it could point to the Spirit of God. So both work. If you are craving the Spirit of God, which is going to nurture you to maturity, you fix your attention on the things of God, on how do I align my life with the Spirit of God that God has put in me. I'm going to align my will. And this goes with other writers when he says, we walk by the Spirit, not by flesh. If you're living by the Spirit, Paul would say in Romans, you're going to automatically begin to do the things that mark an immature Christian person. But if the spiritual milk refers to God's word, in fact, some of your translators, if you're looking at a different translation than mine, mine just says pure spiritual milk. Yours might say the milk that is God's word. How many people have that translation? It points to God's word. That is your translators helping you make the choice. Which one is it? How do we translate this metaphor? So it's very common to say it's God's word. God's Spirit, God's Word. The author of the God's Word is God's Spirit. So you see how they are one, they're very commonly associated. If I'm going to grow, I must come to an understanding of what is good as defined by God. I want to know God. I want to become intimate with God. And the way to do this is to understand the revelation of God, His word. When Martha and I first met, we met in college at Biola University. I was a transfer student. I was in my third year of college. She was also in her third year, and we sang in choir together. That's how we met. And I was intrigued by this woman because, you know, I've had lots of friends and so on, and both guy friends, girlfriends, and so on. And I was thinking, you know, as you look into college, at least in my mindset, I was also thinking about that season of my life, that maybe at this stage in the game of my life, I might meet that person that I could spend the rest of my life with. I don't know. God, what do you have for me? You know, so I'm in college with that kind of mindset and so on. BIOLA stands for Bridal Institute of Los Angeles, by the way, if you didn't know that. That's a joke because a lot of people, especially out of the 80s and 90s, got married before they graduated. So when I saw Martha, apart from initially being drawn to her because she was so dang cute, was that I had learned that she had just come off the mission field, and that was, in fact, her third summer spent in the Philippines. And she looked a bit different. She dressed a different. She wore these Filipino dresses that she had gotten in the Philippines. They were knitted dresses. It's like, where did you buy that? You can't buy that in the normal store. Actually, this was made in the Philippines. I was like, really? Tell me more about that. And I was intrigued. And the more I got to know Martha, I saw her kindness and how fun she was to hang out with. And I was just drawn. And the more I was drawn to her, the more I craved spending time. I wanted to know everything. And it's so funny because to this day, if I get to spend an entire day with Martha, I learn something about her that I didn't know before. There's some characteristic that, again, just draws me. Oh, I love this about you. Or I didn't know this about you. You shared a story or an interaction or something that I'm learning who you are. This is indicative of the kind of craving. We talk about learning who God is. I want to know you. I want to know everything about you. And my heart is filled with, as the more I get to know you, the more I understand, and the more I feel loved. I feel a part of this identity. I feel a part of this group. Like, man, Lord, you are amazing. If I'm going to grow into maturity, I have to crave the spiritual milk, which is God's word or God's spirit, if I'm going to get to know him. Sometimes we feel like God is so distant. I don't know who he is. You know, God, how can we really know God? Well, and oftentimes you're the same individuals who could not tell you where the Gospels are in their Bible. Or, you know, I just don't feel close to God. I just kind of, but they don't spend any time seeking the Lord, either in the Word of God or in solitude or in silence or in prayer, this practicing the presence of God. I believe that God puts in us a decision that we make every single day to crave. And the more we eat something, we crave it all the more. The more we enjoy something, I want more of that thing. God is the ultimate fulfiller and satisfier of the longings of our heart. Crave, like that infant, the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up into salvation, since you have tasted that the Lord is good. You tasted it, you just want more. Now, my translation says if, the word if. That's an unfortunate literal translation because it implies that it may not be true. If you've tasted that the Lord is good, heck, you may not have, but if you did, this is how you should be living. The reality in the Greek metaphor and other translations, you may already translate it, now that you've tasted the Lord of good, or because you have tasted the Lord, since you have tasted the Lord of good. That's a good translation of that Greek word. If is just a literal translation, but it's not meant to imply like it may be that way or it may not. No, it's since it is that way. This is how you to live your life. So the identity, our ethics of the faith community is that we are to grow up into maturity. We do that by craving the Lord God himself and learning about him, spending time with him, enjoying him, that we might grow up into maturity. So if that's the ethics of the faith community, Peter will now go on to tell us the identity. He reintroduces the identity, our new, he's elevated our status in this faith society, a faith community, but now he focuses in on what does this identity look like? And he does this by drawing metaphors from the Old Testament. I'm going to identify those first, and I'm going to go back and unpack it. So first of all, he says, you are living stones in a spiritual house. Let's read that and beginning in verse 4. As you come to him, a living stone, this is referring to Jesus, the living stone, him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house. So we are a part of a spiritual house. What is that spiritual house? We're going to talk about that in a moment. But we are also designated as holy priests, also a reference to the Old Testament. You're building built up to a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So we are living stones in a spiritual house. We are priests offering spiritual sacrifices and with Jesus as the cornerstone of that house, to take the stone metaphor further. So why does Peter use these metaphors? Why does he draw to the Old Testament idea? These are Gentiles. These are people that are not Jews. They don't know the Old Testament and so on. They're coming out of maybe former paganism or ways that are ignorant of the world or of Judaism and God and so on. But Peter consistently through this entire letter draws these rich metaphors. He's already used several, calling them born again into a new family. He used the metaphor of the exile, which is the same with Israel, who wandered in the desert after being delivered from Egypt through after the Passover. And before they get into the promised land, they're looking forward to the promised land. That's a rich metaphor that Peter continues to draw from. And now he says, you're like the temple or a spiritual house, and you are like priests offering spiritual sacrifices. What did this mean to them? What is he saying? What is he referring to? Why is this important? This is a part of our identity. The spiritual house is like a household. A temple is a holy place. Peter says, be holy. God's standard for us is be holy as he is holy. We now, our collective presence here as the people of God, the Bible tells us, we are the temple of God collectively. We are in this place worshiping God. We are, according to Paul in 1 Corinthians, the temple of God. Paul would also say that we individually are the temple of God. God's Spirit comes to dwell in us, and we hold the Spirit of God like the temple, like the Old Testament temple. So this is a common metaphor for the identity of the people of God. You are like a spiritual house. Think about the temple. What happens in the temple? Worship, and worship specifically through sacrifices. So he moves to the second. So not only are you have this identity as the people of God, just like the people of old who were designated by God as his people, but now you, like the priests of old, are offering sacrifices acceptable to God. In the Old Testament, only one part of Israel, one tribe of Israel, could work in the temple. Those were the Levites. And from the tribe of Levi, only one family, the family of Aaron, could be priests who were facilitating the sacrifices in an acceptable way and could enter once a year into the Holy of Holies. It wasn't a common man experience. Even if you were a king or a prophet, you could not enter into the Holy of Holies of the temple. There was a thick curtain that divided the space that enters into that deep place where the presence of God was said to dwell. And what Peter is saying here that is a hallmark of the Christian faith is we no longer need a mediator between us and God. That's the function of the priest. He took the sacrifice of the person, whether that was a sacrifice for their sin, a sacrifice of worship, a sacrifice of thanksgiving, and the priest took that and offered it in an acceptable way to God by following particular rules and so on. And the priest played a mediatory role between the people of God and God himself. When Jesus came, he himself became the acceptable sacrifice. He offered himself. He offered his own body for the sins of the world. And the writer of Hebrews tells us when he did that, he opened up a way into the very presence of God, into the Holy of Holies, that anyone through faith in Jesus Christ, through the faith in his finished works, could enter into that same kind of communion. And so what Peter is saying is that you were formerly not a people. Now you are a people. In fact, you are the temple of God. God dwells among you. Formerly, the people of old needed priests to stand as a mediator between us and God to offer those acceptable sacrifices. But now, through Jesus, you yourselves are priests. You can enter in on your own behalf and offer your own life, your own body, just like Jesus did, as a sacrifice of worship, acceptable to God, with a clean conscience. This is what Paul is getting at in Romans chapter 12. If you keep your finger in 1 Peter, turn to Romans chapter 12. Paul says this very same idea. This is the ethos of the Christian community. This is who we are. It's a part of our identity. Romans chapter 12. After the first 11 chapters of Romans declaring who we are as Christians, saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, now we offer ourselves as living sacrifices, Paul says. Look at chapter 12, verse 1. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice. Formerly, the priests offered the blood of bulls and goats, or grain offerings, or birds. But now, we, because we've been cleansed through our faith in Jesus Christ, don't need a priest any longer. We can enter into the presence of God offering our bodies, our very lives, our very selves in worship to God. He says, I appeal to you by the mercy of God to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. This is our new identity. We ourselves are declared priests. Go back to 1 Peter. And let's read those verses again, 4 and 5. We are living stones built up to a living house through Jesus, like Jesus, and we are priests through Jesus' finished work. Look at verse 4. As you come to him, a living stone, this is Jesus, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. 2, for this purpose, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Now he's going to go into an argument that we are, through this faith in Jesus Christ, we have made a choice of faith. He says in Scripture, verse 6, it stands in Scripture, "Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious. And whoever believes in him will not be put to shame." You're part of this new faith community. It's your identity. You act in accord with the ethos of that community, loving one another, loving God, craving to know God more, and offering yourselves as living sacrifices. And in doing so, you will never be put to shame. Why? Because you're doing so through Jesus. And God has accepted Jesus as the cornerstone of our faith. So, verse 7, the honor is for you who believe. You won't be shamed in your belief. No, you're going to be honored because you have chosen the cornerstone that everybody else rejected. But for those who did not believe, for those who reject Jesus, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. These are passages in the Old Testament, Isaiah 28, the first reference. The second reference is Psalm 118. And finally, a stone of stumbling, a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. We can feel marginalized in a culture that has rejected Jesus. Peter wants us to know, you are chosen and precious in God's sight. He elevates the status, our status in the community. Because of our faith in Jesus Christ, we are like living stones built into the temple of God, and we are offering spiritual sacrifices like priests before him. And he will conclude this section in verse 9 and continue to identify our core identity as believers. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. What are we to do with this experience? What are we to do with this information? And Peter's going to spend a lot of time, the second half of this letter. But he gives us a clue in verse 9. Because you are this people, this chosen race, a holy priesthood, offering your bodies as living sacrifices, you will be proclaiming the excellencies of God who showed you mercy. Let's look at that again. You are a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. A great byproduct of enjoying what it means to be a believer. We have an elevated status in our identity. We have been made of a great value to God himself. I choose you. You are holy and precious in my sight. We belong to a community where we love one another deeply. We are growing in our faith and experiencing of the mercies of God. We lay our lives down to bring God glory. And by doing so, we proclaim who God is to the rest of the world. Are you not fitting in? Is society marginalizing you? Join the church. You will understand what belonging feels like. You will understand what it means to be loved and chosen by God himself. How are we, both as individual, individuals and collectively declaring the excellencies of God by this faith community. How do people identify us and our love for one another? And the ethics we and the values that we hold to as we crave to know God in a deeper way. Are they drawn to Him or are they repelled by Him? It is our job to proclaim the excellencies. And those who are outside looking in will make a choice to reject the cornerstone or to believe and not be put to shame. And we are a light to be able to draw people to this unique and peculiar people of God, chosen by Him in love. Jonathan, you come forward. We're going to end our worship, our time here together with worship of this great song entitled Cornerstone that causes us to reflect on our faith and the essential values that we hold as believers as we look to Jesus, the cornerstone of our faith. Will you stand together as we finish our time here in worship? Join me as we end our service with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for sending your Son Jesus so that we might see the full revelation of who you are, how he loves us, how he laid down his life, that by his blood, the penalty for our sin could be paid in full, that we might have and enjoy the forgiveness of sin and a relationship with you, that we are a new people, a royal priesthood, set apart for you. that will never be put to shame. God, help us to live our lives as living sacrifices of worship for you. We pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Grace and peace to you today.